comes and inhabits your praise, and when he comes in your praise, there is a revelation of God that you've not seen before. That in the midst of magnifying God, he begins to show you who he really is. To magnify God, I want to let you know, has nothing to do with enlarging God. Because the word magnifies means enlarge, it means increase. It's because something was about to happen. God had released something in this planet, and I came to fulfill nothing else than his purpose. And that is the same for you. Somebody shout amen. It's the same for you. You are here not to wipe time. You are here to fulfill. Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, how I love. I love calling your name. You are my Jesus. Precious Jesus. Every day, your name is the same. You are my Jesus. Sweet Jesus. Lord, how I long, calling your name. You were my Jesus, precious Jesus. Every day, your name is the same. How I love, calling your name. Can somebody stand up and give him some worship here? Every day, your name is the same. How I love, calling your name. Every day, your name is the same. You were my Jesus, precious Jesus. How I love, calling your name. Yes, Jesus, Master Jesus. Every day, your name is the same. How I love, calling your name. Every day, your name is the same. How I love, one more time. How I love, calling your name. Your name is the same. And I praise you, Lord. And I worship you, God. I lift high your praise. I glorify your name. You are lifted in the highest place. Lifted in the highest place. You're worthy to be praised. I give you praise. I give you praise. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can somebody raise your hand? Bless the Lord for who he is. Glorify him for who he is. Magnify him for who he is. He is most deserving of praise and honor and power. We give him glory today. Father, we worship in your presence. We magnify your name. Hallelujah. We bless your holy name. Hallelujah. We lift up your praise. Hallelujah. Most worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. We give you the glory and the honor. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Give the Lord a clap of praise. Hallelujah. Psalm 34. Now, before we read the scriptures, I just want to let you know this, that we will, next Sunday, we're receiving a a very fine man of God. He's coming from the States, and he will be ministering next Sunday here. What I want you to do, please, is if you can bring someone along with you next Sunday for the service, would you try and do that? Would you try and do that? Okay, great. Why is it that you don't talk back to me? Would you try and do that? Try. Thank you. Try and do that. Just bring someone along with you next Sunday. We want to have a wonderful service. We always have wonderful services. But sometimes when you have a guest minister coming, it's great. It could be an opportunity. So just bring someone along with you. Amen. And I want you to look forward to the service next Sunday. Look forward to it with excitement. Praise the Lord. Psalm 34. My focus is going to be verse number 3, but I want us to do the from verse 1. Amen. And I want you to read with life. I don't want you to read like you're dragging your feet. You are a soldier of the cross. You are an army of Christ. Come on now. Are you ready? Come on. Ready? Go. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise always be on my lips. My soul will make. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Do that verse 3 again. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us. Can you get it on King James, the verse number 3? Can we get it on King James? It will use another word for glorify. Go. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Amen. Father, thank you for your word today. Now I pray that you think through my mind and speak through my voice and cause the people here today to hear nothing but the voice of the Lord. Now I thank you for humbling flesh and glorifying Christ. Now we pray that this atmosphere is charged up with your presence. Holy Ghost, fill this place with glory and power. Provoke somebody whom the enemy has tried to steal their praise, that today they are provoked to praise you. They are provoked to worship you. Irrespective of what's happening in your life, let praise well out from someone and let the name of the Lord today be glorified. And somebody who is excited and ready to praise God, shout out, amen, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And look at somebody beside you and just say to them, magnify the Lord with me. Talk to 2 or 3 people, magnify the Lord with me. Amen. And let us exalt his name together. You may be seated. Magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Hallelujah. Come on, hallelujah. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. That's wonderful. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I can just keep saying that all day. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. Magnify the Lord with me. You know, when David talks about magnifying the Lord, which is what I want to focus on, that word, magnify the Lord. I want to focus on that. When David talks about magnifying the Lord, you've got to realize that many times when we say magnify the Lord, all our focus just becomes the one that we magnify. And what our magnifying or our worship and our praise does to him. And that is all right, because when we magnify God, we want to make it to be all about him. But what I came to tell you this morning is the other side of magnifying God. That in the process of magnifying God, it is not only God
that is being glorified in the process, but something happens to the one that magnifies him. That in the process, while you magnify God, something happens to your own life. So when we talk about magnifying the Lord, and we make that, we just focus on God and we magnify God, there's another side of it. That in the process, while you focus on magnifying God, God is doing something in the life of the magnifier. The one that is magnifying him. Amen. So something happens when you magnify God. Now, I'm not talking something happening to God, but I'm saying something happens to you when you magnify God. Something happens to us when we magnify God. You know, if you ask Paul and Silas, they will tell you that why they began to praise God at the night hour in the prison, they realize that in the midst of praise, something happens to the praiser. That why you begin to magnify him and you begin to praise him, he comes and inhabits your praise. And when he comes in your praise, there is a revelation of God that you've not seen before. That in the midst of magnifying God, he begins to show you who he really is. That the more you magnify him, the more he reveals himself to you. Something happens to the one that magnifies him. When you praise him, something happens. When you magnify him, something happens. So I know that when we talk about magnifying God, it's always we think about him. But it's great. But today, I just want to show you a little bit what happens to you in the process of magnifying God. You cannot really magnify God and stay the same. No, you cannot. You cannot really praise God and remain the person that you used to be. You cannot really get into the place of praise and worship in the presence of God and remain the same. No, when you really praise God, you get into the place where he dwells. Because the Bible says he inhabits, he lives, he dwells in the praises of his people. So when we bless God, when we praise him, when we magnify him, he comes down and he dwells in our praise and he begins to do things in our lives. Oh, when you magnify God, I know that every time it's all right when we look at a situation and we rebuke it. We look at that and we rebuke, we look at that and we bind. But I want to give you another secret, that sometimes the way you come out of bondage is by magnifying God. That the way you come out of a situation is by magnifying God. It's take your eyes off the situation and focus on the one you're magnifying. And he steps into the situation where you are in. And when God steps in your situation, the situation is too small to handle a big God. When he comes in that situation, something begins to happen. That is why when Paul and Silas praised him in the prison, the Bible says, and God who inhabits the praises of his people. I can imagine why they were praising and they were singing, oh, bless the Lord, and let my soul magnify the Lord. And they were just giving praise to God. And suddenly, I can feel God. The Bible says that the earth is his footstool. I could just imagine God sitting on the throne and the earth is his footstool and God just nodding his head with receiving that praise and receiving that adoration and receiving that worship. And suddenly he began to tap his leg. And when God, the big God, begins to move on earth, there is an earthquake. And that's why the Bible says there was a quake in the prison. And there was a quake and suddenly all the chains break loose. They that were in captivity experienced freedom because they magnified the Lord. You see, when you magnify God, something happens to you. You cannot really praise him and stay the same. You cannot really praise God and remain who you used to be. In the midst of praise, he will change you. In the midst of praise, he will change your circumstances. In the midst of praise, he will change the situation of your life. Look at somebody and just tell them, magnify the Lord with me. Several times you see the psalmist say that in the scripture, like where we just read in Psalm 34, I bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. My soul would make its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear thereof and rejoice. And then verse 3, oh, magnify the Lord Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. In Psalm 69 verse 30, the psalmist declares as well and says, I will praise the name of God with a song, and I will magnify him with thanksgiving. I will magnify him with thanksgiving. The word to magnify simply means to enlarge. It means to make great. It means to increase in size and dimension. It also means to amplify. It means to exaggerate. It means to extol. It also means to glorify. Like another translation will use, glorify the Lord with me. It also means to glorify. So to magnify God, I want to let you know, has nothing to do with enlarging God. Somebody, come on now. Because the word magnifies means enlarge. It means increase. But to magnify God has nothing to do with changing God in his dimension. Come on, somebody. To magnify God has nothing to do with increasing God in his size. He is already big enough. Somebody's not listening to me now. I said, God is already big enough. You cannot make him any bigger. He is big enough. We cannot make God any bigger. So why is the psalmist telling us to magnify a God that we cannot make any bigger? Why is he asking us to magnify a God that we cannot increase in size, or we cannot even change him? Why? Is God a victim of self-esteem that we need to keep telling him how good he is so that he will feel good about himself? Why have we got to magnify him? We are not praising him because he doesn't realize who he is. You know, sometimes there are people who have low self-esteem that you have to constantly tell them how good they are so that they will realize it. They don't know how good they are, so you have to always tell them, oh, brother, you can sing so good. Oh, brother, you can do it. Oh, sister, yes, you can. And they say, can I really? They are not sure of themselves. But when the psalmist tells us to magnify God, God is not suffering from a low self-esteem. God is not without a knowledge about who he is. In fact, the Bible tells us, ever before we declare that he is God, he also declared himself to be God. Come on, somebody. Ever before we praised him, he praised himself. You don't understand what I'm saying. I'm not sure you understand what I'm saying. The Bible says in Isaiah 45 verse number 5, and the Lord himself declared and said, I am God, and besides me, there is no one else. In chapter 44 verse 6, the Lord also declares, I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no other God. So God knows about himself. You know, when we come to magnify God and to praise him, we say, oh, how great art thou. Oh, you are mighty. Oh, you are this. And we are not trying to educate God about himself, because all that we know of him was that which he revealed to us. Somebody getting what I'm saying now? Come on. All that we know of him was that which he revealed to us. So when we come to magnify God, when we come to praise God, we are not trying to make him something that he is not. We are not trying to tell him to discover who he is. He already knows who he is. God already knows that he is God. He knows that there are other gods, and he's not intimidated by any other god, because he stands out and he says, look at them, all other gods. Besides me, there is no one else. I stand apart from them. I am the greatest God. Come on, you don't need to tell me who I am. I already know who I am. I'm God the creator. In other words, God is saying, whether you praise me or you don't praise me, I'll still be God. Whether you worship me or you don't worship me, it doesn't take away from who I am. It is not your praise that makes me God. I was God before you began to praise. I was God before you began to sing. I was God before you began to dance. There is nothing you do to add to me, and there is nothing you will not do to take away from me. I am God from east to the north, from south to the west. I am God. Somebody raise your hand and shout hallelujah. You cannot add to who he is. You cannot reduce to who he is. He is God. Somebody raise your hand and shout, he is God. He is God. He is God. I love this. You know, I heard a preacher say it one time and said, before there was ever a choir, God himself was a choir to himself. Before anybody ever sang praise to him, he stood back and began to sing praise unto himself. Because the Bible says when he created the light, and then he stepped back and looked at it and said, there is no choir, it is good. And then he created the land and he created everything. And then he stepped back and he looked at it again and said, there is nobody to praise me, let me praise myself. It is good. Come on. Before anybody began to tell God how good he is, God himself began to tell himself how good he is. Look at somebody and say, he can do without your praise. He can. Maybe you thought it was your praise that really makes him God. He can do without your praise. Maybe you thought it was your singing that made him God. He can do without your singing. Maybe you thought your preaching is what makes him God. He can do without your preaching. Maybe you thought it was your offering or your tithe or your giving that makes him God. He can do without your money. Come on, am I talking to somebody here today? He can do without your money. He is God all by himself. He is God. We can add to him. We can't take away from him. We can't increase him. We can't reduce him. He is God. Somebody shout out, he is God. He is God. I love serving a God who is not threatened by anything. I love serving a God who is not feeling insecure in any way or in any sense. I love serving a God who is not intimidated by other gods or intimidated by people's inadequacies. I love serving a God who still continues being God even when people say, I am an atheist, I don't believe in him. Your belief system, your concepts don't change who he is. He is God. Come on, somebody, just shout out, he is God. You know, when we say he is God, what am I saying? I want you to get this. In fact, if you don't get this, buy this CD, buy this DVD. You need it. If you don't get this, just buy the DVD, because I know some of you may be trying to write it. But if you can't write it, just buy this DVD. When we say he is God, what exactly are we saying? To say that God is God is to declare first of all that God is self-existent. Now, when you say God is self-existent, it means that he was not created. All things were created by him, but he is the God that was not created. He provoked everything into being, but nothing provoked him into being. He was before time. I heard somebody began to ask, well, God created all things. Who created God? I said, you lost your mind trying to think it. You lost your mind trying to think it. You go mad trying to think it. He is the God that was not created. He is the uncreated creator. He is the uncaused causer. Before things happen, he caused them to happen. He is the undesigned designer. That's the God I'm talking about. He is self-existent. God from time. God in eternity. And God into time. Put him into time, he is God. Take him out of time, he is still God. Come alive, you see him. Die, he will still be there. He is God. Jump up, jump down. Feel strong, feel weak. He is always God. Self-existent God. When we say he is God, we are saying that he is immutable. He is the God that can never change. I am that I am. Do what you want, I'll still be God. Deny me, I will still be God. Believe me, I will still be God. Praise me, I will still be God. Deny to praise me, I will still be God. Worship me, I will still be God. Don't worship me, I will still be God. I cannot change. In other words, God is not moved by our emotions. No, somebody's not hearing me right there now. I heard the last time when somebody talked about this and somebody said, really? So God is not moved when I'm crying. Oh, yeah. I want to let you know. Yes, the Bible says he's got emotion. We've got a high priest who is touched by our infirmities. But I want you to know that emotions don't move him. Faith is what moves him. Are you hearing what I'm saying? For he that cometh to God must believe that he is. And he is the rewarder of them that do not seek reward, but seek God himself. Somebody ought to shout amen right there. He is God. He is immutable. When we say he is God, we are saying he is infinite. When you say he is infinite, you're saying there are no limits with God. You cannot put God in a cage. You can tell this is how far he can go, or that's how far he can go. God is a God without limits. No limits. When we say he is God, we are saying he is eternal. He operates in time, but he comes from eternity. When we say he is God, we are saying he is divine. Divine means that he cannot be completely known. You can never know all of him. I don't care whether you come from the University of Cambridge. You can never know all about God. I don't care how many books you would have written or read about theology. You would never know about God, all about God. See, God is too big. If you try to understand him fully, your mind will explode. You can never know all about him. And we can only know him to the degree that he reveals himself. Somebody shout amen. He is all-powerful, omnipotent. To say he is God means he is omnipotent. To say he is God means he is omnipresent. He is everywhere at the same time. To say he is God means that he is infallible. He is perfect. He makes no mistake. The Bible says that every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of light, in whom there is no variableness, no shadow of turning. To say he is God is to say he is omniscient, all-knowing. He knows everything, even the things that we don't know that we are going to do. He knows about it. How many of you know that God has seen your end from your beginning? To say he is God is to say that he is sovereign. He is a sovereign God. And to say he is sovereign means that he rules supreme over the universe. I've heard people say God created the world and the world has grown beyond his management. He cannot control it anymore. That's why we have earthquakes. That's why we have disasters. Come on, shut up your mouth. Before there was ever an earthquake, God himself said there would be an earthquake. Before ever there was any disaster, floods and whatever, the God who created said there was coming. We never knew about earthquakes until God said there would be one. Anybody hearing what I'm saying? And the Bible says the closer we get to the end of times, the more earthquakes and the more wars we are going to see. Anything we see is not news to God. He knew it ever before we saw it. Somebody shout, he is God. I didn't hear you. Come on, somebody shout, he is God. To say he is God, based on all the above attributes of God I've just mentioned, it's to say that God is self-sufficient. Self-sufficient. When you say somebody is self-sufficient, it means that he needs nothing. He doesn't need your tithe. He doesn't need your offering. He doesn't need your money. He doesn't need your talent. He doesn't need your ability. He doesn't need your preaching. He doesn't need this and that. See, there is nothing we do that makes him God. He is God all by himself. He is self-sufficient. He doesn't need all these things to make him God. My preaching will not make him God. My teaching will not make him God. My singing will not make him God. My giving will not make him God. He is already God. Give or no give, he is God. Worship or no worship, he is God. Praise or no praise, he is God. Somebody shouted, he is God. Look at somebody beside you and say, I don't care what you do. I didn't hear you. Come on, tell them. Are you scared of them? Tell them, I don't care what you do. He is God. You can't take away from him. I'm not hearing you. You can't take away from him. You cannot add to him. He is God. Hallelujah. Give him a praise right there. Give him a praise right there. To say that God is self-sufficient is to declare that God is not in need. He needs no help. He needs nothing because he is complete in himself. To say that he is God and self-sufficient is to say that he is absolute. Absolute. God is absolute. He is big enough and he cannot be bigger. He just cannot be bigger. He's already big enough. You know, I like the way Solomon puts it in 2 Chronicles chapter 2 verse 6. He said, behold the heavens, and the highest heavens cannot contain him. That's how big he is. When he built a temple for God, and he said, Lord, we have built you a house where you should dwell in. He said, but by the way, this house, is it really for you or for us? Are you understanding what I'm saying now? Come on. This offering, is it really for you or for us? This building, is it really for you or for us? We are the ones that will come in here to worship you. God, we want you to come into this temple. Bet, if we think about it, you are bigger than this temple. This temple cannot contain you. In fact, this temple lives in you. The heavens and the highest heavens cannot even contain you. What about a small temple that we build? He is a God so high, but a God that comes so low. He is a God, the king, but the God willing to become the slave. He is the lion of the tribe of Judah, but he is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Anybody getting what I'm saying? Come on now. He is the lion, but he is also the lamb. He is God so big, but he is God so humble. He is divinity revealed in humanity. That's what I'm talking about. God so great, but God so humble. He comes to our low estate that he might reveal himself to us. Somebody just raise your hand and say, thank you, God, for being God. Give you praise, God. Give you praise. Give you praise. Give you praise. If God is absolute, that makes him bigger than we can even imagine. The greatest preacher in the world and the brightest mind in theology cannot even think through who God really is. Till today, when we talk about theology and certain aspects and certain concepts in theology, all we end up doing is arguing. We argue what we think about him. Oh, I think this is what it really means about God. When we say God is absolute, I think this is what it means. When we say God is supreme, I think this is what it means. Everybody has an argument about what they really think God is and who they really think he is. That just tells me he is too big for our mind to contain. So we cannot even know all about him. How then do you make someone you don't know all about bigger? When you don't even know how big he is. Magnify the Lord. Anybody getting what I'm saying now? Magnify the Lord. You don't even know how big he is and you want to make him big? You don't even know how big he is and you're trying to make him bigger? He's got to show you how big he is. Till the day I die, I'll never know how big he is. I'll never know. I'll never get to know, because every day when I wake up, he gives me a new revelation of who he is. I wake up one morning, I say, wow, look at God. I didn't know you are this big. I say, wow, see how big God is. And then I go, I say, God, I praise you. God, I praise you. See how big you are. Hallelujah. And in the midst of praising him, he comes more, because he reveals himself in praise. Oh, come on, somebody. He comes more with a greater revelation and a greater dimension that I've not seen. And then when I see, I go more. I say, wow. God, look how big you are. God, look how big you are. The more I praise him, the more he comes. The more revelations I get. So the more I praise, the more I see. The more I praise, the more I get. The more I worship, the more he reveals himself. Magnifying God is not about God getting big. It's about you discovering how big he is. Somebody shout amen right there. It's not about enlarging God. It's about changing your mindset about who the God you serve is. Oh, come on now, somebody. I see people come to church sometimes and they come to dignify themselves before a big God. Who do you think you are? You can't even get down on your knees and worship him. I tell you, I know the God I serve. It makes no difference if I go down with my suit on the ground and begin to praise him, because he deserves it. It makes no difference if I put my head on the floor, because he deserves it. See, when you look at the word magnify in the Bible many times, then even using it in reference to God, it is used against man. Oh, you're not getting what I'm saying. There are places in the Bible that the Bible says they magnified themselves. Are you getting it? Instead of using it towards God, they used it towards themselves. So they came in the presence of God, and it was themselves that they magnified. And how many of you know that there are times people come in the presence of a big God to make themselves big? Oh, you're not hearing what I'm saying. People come in the presence of a big God to dignify themselves and to magnify themselves instead of magnifying God. You come to, you want to make yourself look so important in the presence of God. When they are praising and they are worshiping, you say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. You come to dignify yourself in the presence of the King of Kings. Thank God he didn't take the breath he gave you. Thank God he allowed you to wake up from your bed this morning. Because I can tell you, when I listened to the news, the kind of things I was hearing on the news were shocking. A woman was just deceived and got a hoax call about the prince. A nurse, and the very following day, because she realized she had been deceived, she decided to take her own life. This woman was dreaming and probably buying things for her children to celebrate a Christmas that she would not be alive to see. You're not hearing what I'm talking about. When you wake up every morning, you have to realize somebody gave you your breath. When you wake up every morning, you have to realize somebody tapped you from your bed that morning. When you slept, you forgot whether you even did exist. You just realize yourself when you wake up and say, oh, somebody's still here. I didn't know I still was here. I'm still alive. Thank God he gave you your life back. Thank God he woke you from your bed in the morning. How dare you come in his presence and feel like you own your own life and feel like you have to dignify yourself and magnify yourself in the presence of the Almighty. If he is God, humble yourself before the Lord and begin to give him praise. If he is God, bow before him and begin to give him praise. If he is God, he deserves everything that we give to him. We don't give it to him to make him God. We give it to him because he deserves it. Somebody shout amen right there. He deserves your worship. He deserves, and he is worth your talent. He is worth your time. Don't tell me you don't have time. You have time for everything. You have time for TV. You have time for party, and you don't have time for God. Don't tell me you don't have time. Don't use even your children as an excuse, because he gave you those kids and he could take them away. Don't stand in the way of God because he is merciful. Listen, if he is God and deserves magnification, bow yourself down. Get out of your comfort and give him the praise that is due his name. Oh, it's my career. Oh, it's my this. Oh, it's my that. Oh, it's my job. Oh, listen, this God can just wink his face and you would disappear into non-existence. He allowed you to live in his world. He allows you to breathe his air. He put you, knit you in as a whole being and allow you to walk around with your mind together. The other day I had two people were just even driving to church this morning. Three people were having a row just by the road, and the other two pushed the one on the road, and the bus rode on him and he was pronounced dead on the scene. God has allowed you to survive how many accidents in your life? How many accidents have you survived in your life? And you want to come in the presence of God and dignify yourself and feel you want to magnify yourself in the presence of the Lord. There is one I know deserves magnification, and it's not you. It's not me. It's him. It's him that deserves it. Can somebody just stand up and magnify him for a minute? Just glorify him for a minute. Come on now. I just want you to open your mouth and bless him for a minute. Just say, God, you deserve the glory for who you are. You deserve the praise for who you are. You deserve the honor for who you are. I give you glory. I give you praise. I give you honor. I give you power. God, I'm not giving it to make you who you are. You are already God, and you deserve what I give you. So I praise you, God. So I worship you, God. So I magnify you, God. So I lift up your name, God. So I bless you, God. I raise your name up high. You worthy Jesus. Come on, somebody, raise your hand and shout unto the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is God and he's worthy of praise. Oh, stop trying to be dignified in his presence. Somebody get out of your comfort and give God a praise that he deserves this morning. Get out of your comfort and give God a worship that he deserves this morning. Get out of your relaxation. Come on, get a little bit uncomfortable and just bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, open your mouth and bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. Give him a clap of praise as you take your seat. Hallelujah. He is God. And he is worthy of praise. He is God. And he is worthy of praise. How then can we magnify God that we cannot enlarge or increase? David, what are you talking about when you call us to magnify God who is already absolute? A God that is already too big. We don't even know how big he is. What are you talking about? David, what do you mean? How can we magnify him? To magnify God has nothing to do with changing a God who is immutable. Because he cannot change. You're not hearing what I'm saying. You cannot change him. So your praise does not change him. Your worship does not change him. To magnify God is to change you. Oh, somebody ought to shout there. To magnify God is not to change God. It's to change me. It's to change you. In what way? It's all about our view of him. Oh, come on now. Frank, can you just come here for a minute? We didn't plan this, but you just came on the spot. Like, come here, brother. Come on. Come on. Give him a big encouragement. Come right up here. Come on, give him an encouragement till he gets here. Thank you. Now, this brother here is using this. Permit me. He is using these, and this is called a magnifier. This is called a magnifier. When this brother uses his natural eyes and his natural lenses, and he looks at the words that are written, he sees them in a certain size. Now, when he takes this magnifier and he puts them on his eyes, their sizes are changed. Come on now, somebody. The size of what he's seeing changes. The writing does not change, but his view changes. Anybody getting what I'm saying now? Come on. Thank you. It is not the writing that changed. It is the view of the man that changed. When the Bible says magnify God, you're not trying to change him in size. It's to change how you see who he is. Come on, somebody. Hey, hallelujah. And I want to let you know something. If your God is too small, your problem is too big. But if your God is too big, then your problem is too small. It is surprising how we all look at the same God, but we see different things. Oh, yeah. We look at the same God, but we see different things. Some people look at God and they cry and say, God, why did you leave me like this? God, what have I done? They blame him for every trouble. But some people look at him and they say, I'm coming out of trouble. I'm coming out of sorrow. I'm coming out of pain. It is not who he is. It is the view that you have. Magnifying God is changing your paradigm. Magnifying God is changing your perception. Magnifying God is changing your eye view of who He is. If your God is too small, your troubles are too big. But if your God is big, your troubles are too small. Somebody shout amen. Thank you, brother. Thank you. So we cannot change a God who is immutable. We cannot change Him. What needs changing is my perception of Him. My view of Him needs changing. The way I see Him needs changing. But God is I am that I am. In Malachi 3 verse 6, He said, I am the Lord and I change not. I change not. I am the Lord and I change not. In James chapter 1 verse 17, He says, all good gifts come from above, from the Father of light, in whom there is no change. There is no variableness. He cannot change. In Hebrews chapter 13 verse 8, He says He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So He will never change. Never you think you can change God, you can never change Him. It is you and I that needs changing. Magnifying God is not about changing God. Magnifying God is changing me. And if you really magnify God, you will change. Anybody getting what I'm saying now? If you really magnify God, you will change. Tell somebody that beside you. If you really magnify God, you will change. So what is all this story about magnifying God? I'm finishing up now. To magnify God is a call to see God. Listen, it's not a changing. It is just a call to see God exactly as He is. It is a call to see God exactly as God is. Magnifying God does not change God. Rather, it reveals God. That's what it does. It's not changing God. It is revealing God to us. It does not change whom we see. But it changes how we see Him. It does not change whom we see, but changes how we see Him. Many of us have distorted views of God. And how many of you know the Bible says, and God created man in His image. The problem with that is that we have turned it the other way around. And man has now created God in His image. In other words, because we hear that God created us in His image, we now have recreated God in our minds to be like us. We are like God. You've heard me say it before. We are like God, but God is not like us. And I'm thankful God is not like us. I am thankful God is not like us. If God were to be like me, oh God, you know what I'm talking about. Some of you would have been having trouble right now. Because for me, I would just say, Lord, shut that door. If God were to be like me, there are some doors you want to pass through. I say, Lord, for what He did, shut that door. For what she didn't do, shut this door. Am I talking to somebody now? Am I? Look at somebody and say, I thank God He's not like you. I thank God. I thank God He's not like you, Brother Dodo. Woo! I thank God He's not like you, Pastor Joseph. I love you, but I thank God God is not like you. I'm serious. I thank God He's not like you. I thank God for just being God. Hallelujah. I thank God for just being God. You can imagine. You are in such love with your friend, even with your own spouse, and one day there's trouble. You say, can I have it? He said, no, you're not having it. Even with your own spouse, one day you just got up and say, you want to have this? No, I'm not saying my wife, I'm saying me. Today you offended me, you're not getting it. But aren't you thankful for a merciful God? Aren't you thankful for a God who is so loving, who is so unconditional? He gives without reservation. Somebody shout amen right there. Magnifying God is a call to see God as He is. He is God. He is not like us. You've got to see Him as He is. And until you see Him as He is, you will continue to see something, a distorted view, a distorted concept of who you call God. He is God. He is God. And we need to get that vision of who He really is. Somebody just shout, He is God. The call, so one, it's the call to magnify God is a call to see Him as He is. And two, the call to magnify God is not only to change our view of God, but to change our view of things around us. You're not getting that. I'll show you now. How many of you know that God does not see the way we see? When you look at a situation and you assess it and you say, that is the situation, that is man's assessment. But when you check with God and get His paradigm, get His view of the same situation, what you may call trouble, He will tell you is an opportunity. You're not hearing what I'm saying? You look at a situation, you say, I am dead, I am finished. God said, come on, wake up. Stop behaving like a baby. See what I'm seeing. You are blessed and you are favored. Magnify God is not only to see God as He is, but it's also to see things the way God sees it. Come from God's dimension. Sometimes when people talk to you, you say, now that is Cristiano talking. Now come from God's dimension. What is God saying? When people talk to you, say, oh yeah, that's Paul. That's how Paul sees it. Now, Paul, how does God see it? Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Come on. People come in situations and say, I'm dead. I'm finished. I'm done. It's over. But when you check with God, He says, son, you're just about to start. You call this your end? God calls it your beginning. You called it, I'm dead? God called it, you're coming back to life. I don't know what you're seeing, but if you are seeing from man's point of view, you may see dead. But when you come from God's perspective, you will see life. Somebody shout hallelujah. Because when men see impossibilities, God declares, with God, all things are possible. When men feel it cannot happen, God says, in my name, it's coming to pass. Where the doctors give a report and they say it's done, it's finished, close the chapter, forget about it. God said, no, it's not done, it's not finished. I am the author and I am the finisher. It's not done until I speak. Somebody shout hallelujah. When people say, I see trouble coming, you say, well, that's man's perspective. What is God saying? The next time anybody comes to you with a frightening news, tell them, have you checked with God? Are you hearing what I'm saying now? Come on. The next time somebody comes to you and brings you a frightening news, just look at them and say, brother, before you finish, have you checked with God? Because the last time I checked, He doesn't see the way you see it. If I have to go just the way you see it, I may die before my time. But I thank God I have denied to see the way you see. I have decided to see it the way God sees it. You see trouble, I see miracles. You see sickness, I see a blessing. You see my end, I see my beginning. Come on, talk to me, somebody. When men have closed the chapter on you, God said, get ready, I'm just about to begin in your life. I have decided I will not look at it anymore in line with man's perspective. I've got to look at it the way God sees it. If I can see it the way God sees it, brother, if I can just see it the way God sees it, I will not kill myself before my time. And that's the problem we have. That's the problem we have. All you see is where you are, but God is seeing where you're going. Oh, look at where I am. Look at the trouble. If God opens your eyes and you see where he's bringing you, you will stop crying about where you are and start thanking him for where you're going. And that's the problem we have many times. And we've seen people take their lives because they can't see where they are going. But look at somebody beside you and say, I know I'm going somewhere. I know I'm going somewhere. Oh, yeah. It may be rough right now, but I know where I'm going. It's not going to be this way forever. It's not going to be this way forever. I know where I'm going. I'm going somewhere with my life. I'm a miracle. No, I hear people say I'm a miracle about to happen. No, I'm not that. I'm already a miracle. I have already happened. Come on, somebody, shout amen. I'm not waiting to happen. I have happened. You see, I happened the day my mother conceived me. And the day I was born, earth rejoiced because something was about to happen. God had released something in this planet, and I came to fulfill nothing else but his purpose. And that is the same for you. Somebody shout amen. Amen. It's the same for you. You are here not to wind time. You are here to fulfill the purposes of God. Did you receive the word today? Come on, did you receive it today? Hallelujah. Let's stand up now. Stand up now, everybody. And what I want you to do is give him praise. I want you to magnify him and see him in a way that you've not seen him before. Magnify him. Magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. Are you ready? Come on, you're not talking to me. Are you ready? See, when I go 1, 2, 3, I want everybody to shout a loud hallelujah. The loudest hallelujah you have ever shouted. When I say 1, 2, 3, I want you to shout hallelujah. But after that, I don't want you to stop. When you go hallelujah, you continue to magnify the Lord. Amen. Come on, I say amen. Amen. You see, when you magnify God and you call him a healer, you are seeing the power of God over sickness. When you magnify God and call him a provider, you are seeing his providence over lack in your life. Somebody ready to magnify the Lord now? I said, somebody ready to magnify the Lord now? Raise your hand. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3, go. Come on now. Magnify him now. Come on, open your mouth. Magnify him. Glorify him. Hallelujah. Yes, God, you are the healer. Yes, God, you are the provider. Yes, God, you are the mighty God. There is no one like you, great in power, mighty in power. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Father. Raso de Elebosha. We glorify you, God. We glorify you, Lord. We lift up the banner of your praise. We magnify your name. We lift up your praise. You worthy, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Magnify the Lord. Magnify the Lord. Hallelujah. Lift up your voice. Magnify the Lord. He's worthy of praise. Yes, God, you are worthy of praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, amen. Come on, amen. Want to hear you, amen. You know, I feel that we should do something a little bit out of the ordinary. I just feel that in me. That we should do something out of the ordinary. Now, I want you to do something you've not done before. If you feel like moving from your seat and walking somewhere to the front, or if you feel like even running around this place, if you feel like jumping and just shouting, if you feel like rolling on the floor, whatever you feel like doing in the next 2 minutes, I'll keep my eye on the time. In the next 2 minutes, don't do what you always do. I wanted to do something that you are not used to doing. As you magnify God now,